So, good evening and good morning as to whatever time you all will be watching this presentation. At the outset, I'd like to thank my dear friend Dr. Ashish Furness, Bombay Orthopedic Society, for this opportunity. I think it's a wonderful concept that Dr. Ashish Furness has come out with of talking about specific journals and specific articles, and that have made a difference in our practices in the recent time. The topic that I am going to introduce is anterolateral rotary instability of the knee, an enigma which has disturbed knee surgeons around the world for many years. And the idea of the presentation is whether, as of today, we have published literature which tells us some guidelines as to how to go about managing these patients with rotary instability. And we are primarily going to talk about a procedure called as lateral extra-articular tenodesis. This is same as what we call as modified Lemaire procedure or as iliotibial band tenodesis. So all three are synonymous. With this introduction, I'll like to talk about my profile. My name is Dr. Nagaraj Shetty. I'm a consultant arthroscopy, shoulder and knee surgeon, which is attached to these hospitals in Mumbai. We also have a fellowship program under the name of Arthrosports, and I'm also the head of department at BDBA Municipal General Hospital, Kandivali. The first article that really became a viral article in the scientific world was this, which came out in 2013 by two Belgian surgeons who basically proclaimed that they have discovered a new ligament in the human knee. After this viral article, there was tremendous amount of buzz among knee surgeons around the world as to what is this new ligament. They labeled this ligament as the anterolateral ligament. In order to label this as a separate structure, they did cadaveric dissections of many knees. They could identify this particular structure in every cadaveric specimen. They found that it runs from the lateral epicondyle to an area near the Girdish tubercle. To be more specific, they identified it running from a point anterior to the lateral epicondyle and extending on to the Girdish tubercle. This was the article. And I would suggest all the listeners and viewers to read this particular article, because I think the one thing that this article did was stimulated a lot of discussion around the world on anterolateral rotary instability. Whether there is a separate ligament or no, or whether it's just a condensation of the known capsular structures on the lateral side was the big debate that happened thereafter. However, this article stimulated various biomechanical studies, various cadaveric studies, various radiological studies, various clinical studies, which has led to the conclusions that I am going to end this particular session with. So this is the article which I was mentioning has made an impact on our practices. And in the next few slides, I'm going to share as to how that impact has really helped us improve outcomes of our patients. Now, why is it important to address anterolateral rotary instability? That is because as of today, we do not have good outcomes in high-risk individuals. What are these high-risk individuals? Patients who are very young, especially the ones who are less than 20, especially the female adolescent athletes, the ones who are involved in high-grade pivoting sports, and most importantly, the patients who have a high-grade pivot shift phenomenon preoperatively. All of us would agree that some of our ACL patients do not have a pivot. Some of them have a very subtle pivot, and some of them have a high-grade pivot. These high-grade pivot patients, we know when we see them that routine ACL reconstruction techniques will not help them. And until this point of time, we didn't have a very clear answer as to how to address these patients. And literature, like this systematic review from Cincinnati, Ohio, has clearly said that younger the age of the patient, high athletic individuals, they will go on to sustain an ACL injury, a re-injury, and a re-tear later on in their lives, and they are a high-risk category. So that is the reason why we need to address these patients. So there is a 30 to 40 times greater risk of ACL injury in this high-risk population. That is the whole crux of finding out a solution for anterolateral rotary instability. So this is what I basically mean by anterolateral rotary instability. So this is the pivot shift test. And very clearly you can see a thud pivot. So you can see the subluxation getting reduced with the thud. So when you have a grade 3 pivot or a thud pivot, you know that there is a significant amount of anterolateral rotary instability and you need to do something extra for the patient. A first indicator that comes to your mind when you see an MRI of these patients is that some patients have got a very mild bone bruise and some have got a significant bone bruise. And this bone bruise pattern, all of us would agree, is very typical. It's on the lateral side, center of the lateral femoral condyle, and posterolateral aspect of the tibial plateau. This is the classic pivot injury. If there is a significant bone bruise, we know that there is also an injury to the anterolateral capsule and the anterolateral structures. So probably these are the ones who are likely to develop a significant rotary instability. So keeping this in mind again, look for bone bruise pattern on MRI and look for corresponding rotary instability in such patients. So this is the first indicator which you can look for. Is this a new concept or is this something that has been studied for centuries? Well, it is not a new concept. Pivot shift phenomenon has been studied for quite some time. There has been review articles which have told us that it is one of the most important tests following an ACL reconstruction, which tell us whether we have achieved rotational control, whether we have restored the rotational laxity. And if there is pivot shift phenomenon post-surgery, then the functional outcomes are poor. So in other words, a positive pivot shift is directly proportional to poor functional outcomes. So this is a review article by Ayani et al., who basically mentioned that pivot shift phenomenon post-surgery indicates poor outcomes. And therefore, we need to negate the pivot shift post-surgery. Another very good randomized clinical trial by Mohtadi et al. From Calgary, Canada. What they did here was they compared the hamstring grafts versus the bone patellar tendon bone grafts. The hamstring grafts were reconstructed in two ways, a single bundle reconstruction and a double bundle reconstruction. It was seen that about 20% of the patients had a residual pivot shift phenomenon more than grade 2, and there were higher failure rates in these patients. So this was noticed in 20% of the hamstring graft patients. So the BTB graft patients fared slightly better. The hamstring graft patients, about 20% of them, so out of 100, about 20 of them continued to have a pivot shift more than grade 2. And this was labeled as an atraumatic graft failure. So with these two review articles, we know that pivot shift is an important indicator of functional outcome. And 20% of hamstring graft patients do continue to have more than grade 2 pivot shift phenomenon. And all of us who have done ACL reconstructions over the years have realized that that is a very known phenomenon in post-op follow-ups. When we see these patients, they do continue to have pivot shift phenomenon. But at the same time, we've also noticed that they do not necessarily complain of instability. So the functional outcome of whether it's hamstring single bundle, double bundle, or a BTB, even in the presence of some pivot shift, the functional outcome has been found to be the same. And they labeled this as an ACL quality of life score. Now, this is a phenomenon that is not explained as to why some patients post-surgery with a pivot shift phenomenon continue to feel unstable and some do not. So generally, the functional outcomes are the same. The probable explanation is that the patients modify their functional activity post-surgery. They prevent themselves from getting into pivoting activities. They are always cautious of their knees. And that is not a good functional outcome. We are talking about young athletic individuals and their ability to go back to all the athletic and the pivoting activity that they wish to perform. So this is the conclusions of this nice review article from Mohtadi et al. Now, as I was saying, is anterolateral rotary instability a new concept or is it something that has been studied over the centuries? I think we all are aware of the Sigon's fracture. The Sigon's fracture was described by Paul Sigon, a French surgeon, way back in the early 1900s. And this is how the Sigon fracture looks like. We see this once in a while, say about once in 6 months or so. We see these capsular avulsion fractures on the lateral tibial plateau side near the Gerdes tubercle. And we know that it is pathognomonic for ACL injury. People have gone to the extent of saying that probably the anterolateral ligament is inserting at this point, and this is nothing but an avulsion of the anterolateral ligament, which has been nicely studied. And I'm going to show you the conclusions of the same. For now, let us just understand that the Sigon's fracture was the first entity which told us that these patients do develop some sort of an injury on the lateral side. And the location is posterior to the Gerdes tubercle. Sigond mentioned this as a poorly resisted fibrous band at the anterolateral aspect of the knee. So Paul Sigond probably needs to be credited as the first gentleman to probably think as to something extra gets injured in these pivoting injuries on the anterolateral aspect of the knee. So what are we talking about when we talk about the anterolateral aspect of the knee? So this is the superficial layer of the knee. So that's just the skin is out. And what are the structures that are important? So you've got the superficial iliotibial band, which inserts onto the Gerdes tubercle. And you've got the extension of the IT band, like the iliopetalar band. The biceps femur has been shown just for orientation. So what I want all of you to look for is the superficial iliotibial band running across the lateral aspect of the knee, covering the lateral joint capsule and inserting onto the Gerdes tubercle. Now, we are reflecting the superficial IT band to look at the deep IT band. So that's the superficial IT band. We are reflecting it. So the first important structure that we need to talk about was described by Kaplan in JBJS American 1958 as condensations of the deep IT band which merge onto the metaphysis of the distal femur. And there are two components of it, the proximal Kaplan fibers and the distal Kaplan fibers. Now, these are extremely important condensations of the deep IT band, and it has been proven beyond doubt that these Kaplan fibers do help in rotational stability on the lateral aspect of the knee, and these have to be preserved. Damage to these can lead to rotational instability. So, we have talked about the Sigond's fracture, we have talked about the deep Kaplan fibers, which is nothing but attachments of the deep IT band to the distal femur. Let's go ahead as to what history has further shown us. Philip Lobenhofer from Germany clearly showed that the deep IT band also gives off condensed fibers called as the retrograde condylar fibers, which are the attachments from the deep IT band to the lateral tibial plateau. Kaplan fibers are from the deep IT band to the distal metaphysis. Retrograde condylar fibers are from the deep IT band to the lateral tibial plateau. In addition, they merge with the layer called as the capsulo-osseous layer, which I'm going to show now. So the retrograde condylar fibers are the condensation from the deep IT band to the lateral tibial plateau. And these fibers merge with the capsulo-osseous layer, which is, as just shown, going from that particular point to the Gerdes tubercle. So there are three important structures on the lateral aspect of the knee. Number one is the Kaplan fibers. Number two is the retrograde condylar fibers. And number three is the capsulo-osseous layer, which has been marked in asterisks. So let's go ahead to the same article, which reignited the discussion of anatomy that has already been done. Coming back to the same question, whether there is a new ligament or it is just a condensation of the known three structures that we just discussed. So the parallel groups of high volume knee surgeons started working on anatomical dissections, on MRI studies, on sonography studies, and try to find out if it's a separate ligament or no. Meanwhile, the Italian group also did these dissections and confirmed the Belgian group study that yes, there is a separate ligament. However, confusion started coming in. The Italian group, etc., said that the anterolateral ligament starts proximal and posterior to the lateral epicondyle and inserts onto the point somewhere between Gerdes tubercle and fibula head. Whereas the Belgian group pointed out and the French group pointed out that the anterolateral ligament starts anterior to the lateral epicondyle and inserts onto a point between the Gerdes tubercle and the fibula head. So the confusion was on the femoral side of this ligament. On the tibial side, there was a consensus. So if there is a ligament, why is there so much amount of variation? That was the first point which started putting doubts into the mind of surgeons whether this is a separate ligament or no. We all know about Dr. Freddie Fu and his push for double bundle reconstruction. So all the way between 2008 to 2012, for about 4 or 5 years, there was a lot of buzz on double bundle ACL reconstruction. And he was a proponent of reconstructing the posterolateral bundle separately for these patients with rotary instability. And that, the concept behind it, we all know that the ACL has got two bundles, the anteromedial bundle, which provides protection against anterotibial translation, and the posterolateral bundle, which provides protection against tibial rotation. However, it went into disrepute and it was not so popular because of more complications and multiple studies showing that it didn't really fare well on the rotational control component. This is the slide again from the Belgian surgeons who use the same concept of Redifoo, saying that only the two bundles are not important because you have a structure in the center of the knee. If you want to prevent this sort of a rotational, significant rotational instability, you need to have a structure on the outside of the knee so that there is a longer lever arm for the knee to be stable. And that is the reason why you need to reconstruct the anterolateral ligament. And the routine posterolateral bundle reconstruction is not effective. They presented this in the 2013 AAOS meeting, and they did a cutting study with a pivot shift measurement computerized documentation of rotational laxity. So what they did here was they cut the anteromedial bundle first and noted that there was no change in the pivot shift phenomenon. They then cut the anteromedial and the posterolateral bundle. There was only a single point increase in the rotation and the pivot shift phenomenon. When they cut the ALL, however, there was a 3-point increase in the internal rotation and the pivot shift phenomenon. And what's important to note is even if you keep the ACL intact and cut only the ALL, there was a rotational increase and a pivot shift increase. And that's, according to them, the clinching evidence that you need to look at the anterolateral ligament and reconstruct it. So they gave a nice anatomical study. They gave a nice cutting study. They gave a nice biomechanical data about the pivot shift and the rotational increase after cutting this particular ligament. And there was convincing evidence that you need to reconstruct this. However, Freddy Fu and group and many other surgeons, including Andrew Amis from Imperial College London, didn't buy this argument. They went ahead with further dissections and said that the capsular osseous layer, which we just discussed in the anatomical specimens of Kaplan and Lobenhofer, they said it is the same structure, and it is just a condensation of this structure, which if you try to identify as a ligament, you can, but it is not having the characteristics of a separate ligament. So what they did was they did a ultrasound study, they did a MRI study, they did a histological study, they even dissected fetal knees, they dissected knees of chimpanzees, etc., to find out if there is a separate ligament, and came to the conclusion that no, there is no separate ligament. It is just that the same deep IT band in deep flexion, about 135 degree, folds on itself, giving the appearance of a separate ligament. And they have dissected more than 80 specimens to prove their point. And copy of the anatomy is what already discussed, as has been shown by Kaplan, Terry, Lobenhofer, is that there are only three important structures on the lateral side. The Kaplan fibers, which are the fibers running from deep IT band to the distal metaphysis of the femur. The capsular osseous layer, which is the condensation of the deep IT band inserting onto the Gerdes tubercle, and the retrograde condylar fibers, which are inserting onto the posterolateral tibial plateau. And there is no separate ligament. This was confirmed by the Imperial College group of Andrew Amis, and they said that there is no need to reconstruct separately the anterolateral ligament. They said that the IT band was the primary internal rotation in both the ACL and the ACL intact and the ACL deficient knees. And they concluded that the IT band has contributions from its deep aspect and from the capsule osseous component. And with these data, they suggested there is no advantage of reconstructing a separate anterolateral ligament. So with this conclusion, the question still remains as to what is the reason some patients develop pivot shift, and how do we make sure that post-op they do not have the same amount of rotational laxity? Whether we need to do an ACL alone, whether we need to do something on the IT band side, whether we need to do something about the capsule, whether the medial meniscus injuries and the lateral meniscus injuries contribute to this pivot shift phenomenon, and whether the bony morphology, the variations in the bony morphology between various patients are contributed to this. The answer is pivot shift is not a single point phenomenon. It's a multifactorial phenomenon. Couple of answers are very crystal clear in our minds today, and I'd like to share that with you. As far as the menisci is concerned, the medial meniscus. So we always say that you need to look at the corners. So if you have a medial meniscus ramp lesion, which is a meniscocapsular separation, you will have an exaggerated lacman, and you will have a high-grade pivot. This has been seen in our clinical practice and proven scientifically. When you have a lateral meniscus root tear, also you see a high grade pivot shift phenomenon. So the first thing that you need to see in your arthroscopy is the corners. If any of these injuries are there, you need to address them, and it will address the pivot shift phenomenon. If the menisci on the median and the lateral side are normal, you need to then be aware of the lateral aspect, and you need to do something in addition to the ACL on the lateral aspect of the knee. Not a complete reconstruction, but a modified technique to make sure that the rotary instability is addressed. And what is that which you can do is what we call as a lateral extra-articular tenodesis. So this is the same video. So the patient is in the pre-op situation now. There's a high-grade pivot. You have ruled out the pathologies on MR or on arthroscopy. You need to be more careful, and you need to look for these two important lesions, the medial meniscus ramp lesion and the lateral meniscus root tears. Two quick videos as to how we go about that. So this is the scopy of the right knee. The hook probe is coming from the anteromedial portal, and most of the surgeons would agree when, if you just see the arthroscopy in the front of the knee, that this is a normal meniscus. However, we always go into the posterior medial corner between the medial femoral condyle and PCL. And therefore, in our practice, we are seeing about 20 to 25% of this lesion called as a medial meniscus ramp lesion. So you can see that there is a capsule, that's the meniscus, and there's a large separation of the meniscus from the capsule. You are likely to miss this lesion if you do a scopy only in the anterior aspect of the knee. So never ever conclude your arthroscopy diagnostic round without going into the posterior medial corner, or you'll miss this lesion. Similarly, the lateral meniscus root avulsion. This is the classic root avulsion. As you can see here, right knee, view from the anterolateral portal, hook probe coming from the medial portal, that is a root avulsion. We come with these sort of anti-grade devices. This is the knee scorpion. We take the stitches through the root like so. We create two such loops, and we create a separate tunnel for the root in addition to the ACL tunnel like so, and pull the root into that tunnel to make sure that you have pulled that entire root and along with it the lateral capsule and restore the rotational stability. So this is when there is an intra-articular pathology. However, if the intra-articular pathology is not there, then how do we come to the conclusion as to how to take care of these patients? I think this is the article which I would like to share with all you people. Is the this is a consensus article wherein all the top knee surgeons across the globe, including the conflicting groups of Andrew Amis and the Belgian surgeons, all came together in London and gave a few consensus as to whether there is a separate ligament or no, when you need to reconstruct it, what are the biomechanical data that is available, and that I'd like to share with you their conclusions. So the first thing they concluded that the anterolateral ligament is a capsular structure within layer 3 of the anterolateral capsule of the knee. So it is not a separate ligament, but a capsular structure within the anterolateral capsule. It has got a varying morphology. It is variable in size and thickness. And most importantly, it attaches proximal and posterior to the lateral epicondyle and attaches somewhere between the fibular head and the Gerdes tubercle. In addition, this particular thickening has got attachments to the lateral meniscus and to the posterolateral tibial plateau. So this was the anatomical conclusion of that consensus group. So we know that if we do something on a point between the proximal and posterior to the lateral epicondyle to the Gerdes tubercle, if we can put a restraint there, we will be recreating the anatomy of this thickening of the anterolateral capsule. The second conclusion was that the primary soft tissue stabilizer for anterior translation and internal rotation near extension is the ACL. So the primary stabilizer near extension for internal rotation is the ACL. However, the IT band along with the Kaplan fiber system and the thickening of the anterolateral capsule, which we just discussed, are in addition secondary stabilizers. So if you do an ACL reconstruction and additionally do an IT band tenodesis, you are likely to restore this internal rotation stability. There is no consensus about the Sigon fracture being the insertion of the anterolateral ligament, because it was found that in this region, all the structures, that is the deep IT band, the biceps aponeurosis, and the anterolateral capsule thickening, all of them insert in this area. That was the next conclusion. And they did conclusion of the biomechanical studies that the fear of over-constraint of the knee. There was a lot of buzz about if you do something on the lateral side of the knee, you will be over-constraining the knee. So the conclusion was, yes, there is a risk of over-constraining the knee, especially if you fix it in external rotation, if you fix it with over-tensioning of the graft. So two things that we are very careful about is do not over-tension the graft and do not fix in external rotation. You should always fix it in neutral rotation. If you take care of this, as of today, there is no clinical evidence that if you add a LET, lateral extra-articular tenodesis, to your ACL, there is going to be over-constraint. There is also a fear of progression of osteoarthritis. However, to date, there is no data that there is going to be an increased risk of osteoarthritis. However, as surgeons, we always are careful in those patients who have started developing some amount of cartilage wear on the lateral compartment. So if there is some amount of cartilage wear on the lateral compartment, it is counterintuitive that you don't want to over-constrain that compartment, because this data might vary in a few years' time. So as of today in our practices, in patients who do not have any chondral wear, with these guidelines, we are not worried about over-constraining the knee and about osteoarthritis. So which are the patients whom you should be thinking in terms of doing a lateral extra-articular tenodesis? Yes, there is a consensus from this group. You would think about these in cases of revision ACL, because they've already gone through a reconstruction, a failed reconstruction, and you don't want to take any chances with them. Definitely our primary patient of high grade pivot shift. Then come the high risk category, the patients who have got a generalized ligamentous laxity and a genorecurvatum. This is another area where knee surgeons find it very difficult to achieve good outcomes, because whatever graft you put, they ultimately stretch out, and an LET can help in providing them that extra stability. And definitely young adolescents, especially young adolescent girls who are involved in high grade pivoting activities. I think these are the very clear cut indications which most of us knee surgeons agree as to be the indications for a lateral extra-articular tenodesis. So this was the findings of this consensus group. About 13 findings were very clearly shown. Then coming to another landmark paper, and this was a recent award-winning paper, again from Alan Gedgood, who has done phenomenal work along with some Belgian surgeons like Peter Verdonk. They tried to find out the stability outcomes. So all these centers, multi-centric study, they all came together. They compared their stability outcomes after combining the LET with the ACL. Let me point out that the LET is basically being done from somewhere around 2012, 2014. And it is not a new procedure. It is the same extra-articular procedure which we have read, wherein the strip of IT band is refixated into the distal femur. It is a modified procedure, and I will share during the surgical videos as to what is really modified on the lateral side. So this modified IT band tenodesis along with ACL in this stability study group showed excellent outcomes. So the conclusion was the addition of a lateral extra-articular tenodesis to a traditional single bundle anatomical hamstring tendon autograft ACL reconstruction, which we do in our patients who have high risk of failure, it resulted in a statistically significant, clinically relevant reduction in graft rupture. And there was reduction in persistent rotary laxity at 2 years after surgery. So when you do an LET along with an ACL, according to the stability group, which is having surgeons of high repute around the globe, it has been concluded that improves the outcomes and reduces your risk of graft re-rupture. So with this confidence, we now are capable of doing the same procedure for our patients. And I'll discuss a few tips and tricks as to how I have been going about doing these lateral extra-articular tenodesis in my practice for the last 3 to 4 years and having excellent outcomes. So ACL reconstruction is done as per routine. So you create your femoral tunnel, you create your tibial tunnel. Having done that, your graft has been prepared. Now you take an incision, as you can see in this video. So you do your marking from the lateral epicondyle, so that's the lateral epicondyle, to the Gerdes tubercle. You mark out the fibula head, that's the posterior border of the IT band, and that's the lateral femoral condyle. So you take an incision from the lateral epicondyle to the Gerdes tubercle, like so. With practice, you can reduce your incision size. So you take a deep dissection all the way to the IT band. You clear out the subcutaneous tissue and the fat over the IT band and expose the iliotibial band. Once you have exposed the iliotibial band, this is how it will look. You then take a marking pen, identify the lateral epicondyle, take the posterior half of the IT band, because that is the portion which overlies the lateral epicondyle, preserving the posterior deep IT band, because as we discussed, those are the fibers of the IT band which merge with the Kaplan fibers and with the retrograde condylar fibers, and we want to preserve those. So the part which is in the lower half is taken as a strip. We want the strip to be 1.5 centimeter wide and about 8 to 10 centimeter long. So with these guidelines, you then take 15 number blade and you start incising the IT band. You need to be deep enough to create a strip. You need to be superficial enough not to damage the deep structures. So that's the way you go about. You keep the distal attachment intact. Release the attachments to the deep tissues with your 15 number blade. Use your dissecting scissors. Once you're happy with the length of the strip, detach it proximally. Keep the distal attachment intact. Until now, we are not doing anything different than what the traditional extra-articular procedures historically have been described. So that's the strip of IT band with the distal attachment intact. The next thing is you whip stitch the ends of it with high tensile suture, because if you're using a screw technique, you don't want it to get ruptured. You whip stitch the end of the graft. Once that is done, this is how it will look. You're now ready for the modified Lemaire technique. So what you do in this is you identify the lateral collateral ligament. You create fascial incisions anterior and posterior to the lateral epicondyle, and you create a track under the lateral epicondyle, and this particular IT band strip is passed under the lateral collateral ligament. So that's the first modification. So that's the track being created and the suture of the IT band strip being fed into this track. You can see now the IT band strip being pulled under the lateral collateral ligament. So what's the beauty of this procedure? Another video of being passing the strip under the lateral collateral ligament. So you have the fulcrum of the lateral epicondyle above. You have the restraint of the natural lateral collateral ligament on the lateral aspect of this new strip, which provides a dynamic rotational stability for these patients. You then select the point proximal and posterior to the lateral epicondyle, going by the anatomical studies which we discussed in detail. So this is my present technique. I use a cautery and roughen up the area proximal and posterior to the lateral epicondyle. Initially with the cautery, remove all the soft tissue attachments at that point. You then use a periosteum and roughen up that area thoroughly. So that's the nicely prepared raw area for a graft to heal. I then use a small guide wire for my suture anchor. That's my preferred technique, a suture anchor technique. So the guide wire has been placed. I then place the suture anchor at this point. You need to ideally be very careful at this point to prevent the collision into the ACL tunnel. So I'll discuss a few tips and tricks as to how we go about doing that. So the anchor has been placed, but at this point of time, I immediately put the arthroscope into the medial portal and visualize if I have violated the ACL tunnel. It is surprising that such a small anchor also violates, and I've got a video to show the same. So the scope is in the medial portal, and you can see that anchor is coming into the tunnel. So I'm withdrawing it now. If I don't take care of this, the anchor will remain inside the tunnel, damaging your loop of your ACL graft. So I directed the anchor slightly proximal and directed it slightly anterior and managed this particular problem. So once you do that, you do this lockdown suture technique. And so that's the lockdown suture technique. So when you pull on that suture, the graft gets pulled into that raw area, and then you can tie multiple stitches. Now the position of the knee, as you can see here, is at 60 degree flexion with neutral rotation. Although biomechanical studies have shown that you could fix it anywhere between 0 degree to 60 to 70 degree. However, most surgeons would practice this at around 60 degree. So the sequence of the steps are, you drill your ACL femoral tunnel, you drill your ACL tibial tunnel, you create your IT band strip, I put the anchor, I visualize it like I said, once I'm sure, I pass the stitches through the IT band. However, I don't lock it down like you saw here. I go back, pass the ACL graft, fix it on the femur, I fix it on the tibia, and then come back and fix the IT band tenodesis. So that's the sequence that I follow. You could also fix it on the femur, fix the IT band, and then do the tibial fixation. However, I like to finish off the ACL fixation and then do the IT band tenodesis. So that's the order of events. And this is the preoperative Lachman of the patient whom we just saw. You can see the significant anterior translation. He also had a high grade pivot. That's the excellent stability that you see. You also see very good rotational stability in these patients. So my tips and tricks for avoiding tunnel collision that you just saw, you could drill the ACL tunnel outside in. So in which case you have an oblique trajectory and you have a complete control about the direction of that tunnel, unlike in the hypoflexion position where you have no control of the exit of the ACL tunnel. So that's the outside in drilling technique, which is an excellent technique if you want to be sure of avoiding tunnel collision. So this is using a flip cutter. So you can see the flip cutter coming in. So that's the guide wire in the ACL tunnel. And then what you need to do is drop your hand down towards the floor and direct it proximally. So that's the guide wire being, your hand is dropped down towards the floor and you need to direct it anteriorly and proximally. Similarly, your reamer has to be about 25 millimeters deep. And you can see all throughout my scope is in the medial portal, making sure that my guide wire is not violating into the ACL tunnel. So this is the screw technique, which I have presently abandoned because I feel that in our patients, the lateral femoral condyle size is quite small and the risk of tunnel collision is quite high. However, if you prefer this technique, these are the guidelines which you can follow. With the anchor technique, usually there is no problem, but if you have such issues, you could go slightly proximal and direct it anteriorly. And that's the screw fixation. I also feel that there is a risk of over-constraining the knee when you have a tight fixation with a biocomposite screw. That's a couple of reasons why I've shifted onto the anchor technique. The third technique that you can use is put a staple onto the prepared raw surface, and that could also serve the same purpose. That's the screw technique. My take-home message is that the anterolateral ligament is not a separate ligament. It is part of the anterolateral capsular complex. The present consensus is against creating a separate tunnel and anterolateral ligament reconstruction. Whether you call it IT band tenodesis, lateral extra-articular tenodesis, or modified ligament procedure, it's a very successful procedure for these specified indications like high-grade pivot shift phenomenon, revision ACLs, hyperlax individuals, and individuals who have a hyperextension, significant hyperextension, and for patients who are young adolescents with involvement in high-grade pivot shift sports. Always be aware of tunnel collision. Use the outside-in technique, use the drilling angle anterior and dropping your hand down technique with the arthroscope in the medial portal to make sure that you're not violating the ACL tunnel. And beware of preventing over-constraint of the knee by fixing it in 60-degree flexion and neutral rotation. Thank you very much.
Excellent presentation, Dr. Shetty. And I mean, for the benefit of the listeners and the residents who are who will be watching this, or for an occasional arthroscopy surgeon who does the ACL once in a while, do you think looking at the stability trial, the number of candidates they had recruited, the proponents and the opponents of this technique, that this is something that is here to stay, or you have your reservations about it? I mean, you said that these three articles changed the way you practiced. So Can you just enlighten on that from your experience over the last 10 years? What is the proportion of the ALLs that you are doing in your ACL reconstructions in your practice?
Yeah. So great question, Ashish. Yes. So great question. I think first part I'll answer about what I feel is the future of this procedure. Looking into my experience in knee surgery since about 14, 15 years, we see a constant change in the trend every 5 years. So therefore, we need to look at literature with a pinch of salt always. Anything that is new need not be immediately tried. We need to look at it for our patient population and with modifications which suit our patient population. So therefore, I would be wary of data related to over constraint of the knee. I would be wary of data related to increased arthritis progression, which might come out in future long-term studies. These are all two-year studies. They are not about 10-year or 15-year studies. So when the long-term studies come, we might see these complications. So therefore, I would advise the young surgeons to look at this with a pinch of salt, all this data. However, for those patients whom we didn't have an answer until now, for those patients who have already suffered a re-rupture, this is a boon. Because I have seen this with my own follow-ups of about 3 to 4 years now, including army recruits. I have done these extra-articular tenodesis for revision cases. Even in army recruits, they are having phenomenal stability, which was not routinely seen in revision ACL patients. I'm also very happy with the outcome of this procedure for patients with high-grade pivot shift, because the confidence which they have in returning to pivoting sports has really increased. So I think these are the main two indications. Doing them for ligament laxity, doing them for hyperextension knees, and doing them for young adolescent girls who do not have a pivot shift phenomenon, I think you need to be very careful. You need to do the classic indications first, have a physiotherapy protocol where you're making sure they do not develop a fixed flexion deformity, they get their range of motion early. Your team knows what a lateral extra-articular tenodesis outcomes are. Then you progress on in increasing your indication.
Right.
These would be my suggestions for
you. Excellent. I think that answers most of the questions. And so to, ask you the last part of the question, like, let's say if you were doing 100 ACL reconstructions in the year, let's say 2012, and you're doing 100 ACL reconstructions now in 2021, with the same kind of patient population that we see, you know, our patients generally playing kabaddi, badminton, squash, or the occasional footballer or the weekend warriors who we see, apart from the military recruits. So what sort of a percentage would you say that you are addressing the ALLs in these patients?
Again, a great question. I think it's got to do with what sort of a practice pattern we have. So I do have a practice pattern where I have patients coming with high demand. So therefore, my numbers will be higher than probably somebody else who has more of recreational athlete patients. So in my case, I would say about 25% of our cases now, we are looking at doing something extra.
Right.
Now that ALL the IT band tenodesis is just one of them. We are very careful in looking at every aspect. So in preoperative evaluation, we are looking at their pivot shift phenomenon. Examination under anesthesia, we are looking at the pivot shift phenomenon. Intra-articularly, we are looking for the pathologies. So if I see a pivot shift phenomenon with an intra-articular pathology, I will not do an additional IT band tenodesis.
Mm-hmm.
If I have a revision ACL, I have a low threshold for doing IT band tenodesis. If I have a patient who has a high-grade pivot, which has been reflected under anesthesia, because many a times you not necessarily see it pre-op. So we have kept this reconstruction technique, the implants and the instrumentation ready in all our cases. Because of the sudden evidence of under anesthesia, if I see a high-grade pivot, immediately we are adding this procedure and it adds only about 20 minutes of extra time. So about 25% of our patients, we are looking closely for doing something extra.
Right. Any of these papers that you reviewed, do they have any pointers to the general orthopedic surgeon to be looked at in the MRI scans or the diagnostic modalities preoperatively? I mean, they all give recommendations regarding the post-op and the clinical findings, but is there anything that you see on the MRI which should sort of alert you to the possibility that this ALL could be ruptured, or this is a patient in whom I might consider that?
Again, yeah, great question again. So let me put it this way. You can have a high velocity injury, as in a road traffic accident, or you could have a high rotary injury. So let us say you have a patient who had an injury while skiing down. So for example, they had a high jump, and when they landed, there was a significant twist. So there has to be an immediate pointer that this particular patient will have significant bruising on the lateral side. This particular patient will have injury to the lateral structures. And when they are in their prehab phase, this injury might heal by itself or persist, but it will be the first pointer. So a patient who is having a high rotary injury. The second thing, and that is something that I need to really point out, is patients with a high body mass index. And you would agree that today we are seeing obesity or high BMI as an epidemic. Even a simple dance maneuver, even playing on a trampoline, a young girl who's on a higher BMI side, even on a trampoline, when they have this because of their body weight, the chances of injuring the lateral structures, lateral meniscus, etc., becomes very high. We always see secondary injuries in there. So not necessarily high velocity, but also the mechanism, body mass index, the MRI evidence of bone bruise, and in the follow-up evaluation, you get a single chance to do their pivot phenomenon. So you quickly do the pivot phenomenon on your OPD table. And if you find that they have a correct pivot, that means their lateral structures have not healed and you need to do something extra. If they don't have a meniscal pathology, if they have a meniscal pathology, you would stop only there. You would not do anything extra.
Excellent. I think that about sums up everything that we would want to know. And I mean, of course, the people can ask questions on the YouTube channel as and when they come. And we will make it a point to address all those queries. Okay. So thank you very much, Dr. Yes. Nagaraj Shetty. Thank you very much on the behalf of the Bombay Orthopedic Society. Thanks.
Thank you. And congratulations to you on this initiative. And hope it's a grand success.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you.